Welcome to South Australia, a place where the winds of change are quite literal and the sun doesn't just warm our homes but also powers them. I am here in beautiful Adelaide today. It's pretty small and unassuming city, the capital of South Australia. Those of you watching from other countries might not know much about this state at all. Its population is just under 2 million and 1.3 million of that is here in Adelaide. And when I think of South Australia, I think of koalas and wine from the Barossa Valley and wildflowers in the desert. But I also think of renewable energy because South Australia is actually leading the world in several key aspects of the energy transition. South Australia has gone from a coal-powered electricity grid with virtually no renewables in 2008 to 70% renewables with zero coal power plants today, a mere 15 years later. And they've done it the hard way. Keep watching and I'll explain what I mean by that. In this video, I'm going to talk about how far South Australia has come, the challenges they've faced, and the solutions that they're implementing. I'm Rosie Barnes, an engineer with a PhD and decades of experience developing clean energy technologies. Welcome to Engineering with Rosie. So, South Australia's electricity in the last 12 months was 70% renewable. That is impressive, but it's not in itself world-leading. Other countries have higher proportions of clean energy in their electricity grid. Iceland is at 100% renewables, made up of hydro and geothermal. Norway is 99%, mostly hydro and some wind. Sweden is 98%, with about two-thirds hydro, one-third nuclear. And there are other examples, Paraguay, Bhutan, Lesotho, Nepal, all in the high 90s, pretty much all from hydro. The thing that those places have in common is that they are blessed with fantastic natural hydro resources, and or geothermal in the case of some of the other countries. Those kind of renewables are easy to incorporate into a grid. They behave just like the coal, gas, or nuclear generators that traditional electricity grids use. South Australia, on the other hand, doesn't have hydro or geothermal resources, and nowhere in Australia is allowed nuclear, so their 70% renewables is made up entirely of variable renewables, wind and solar. And that's what I meant when I said they're doing it the hard way. This is the highest proportion of variable renewables in a gigawatt scale grid anywhere in the world. Denmark is another country making their electricity grid work with a lot of variable renewables. They are a little ahead of South Australia overall. It's 84% renewables, but they get 55% from wind and 6% from solar. Most of the rest is from bioenergy, which again is a generation technology that behaves much like fossil fuels. So Denmark's variable generation, the hard part, is not quite at the level of South Australia. And Denmark has one other advantage that we don't have here. They're interconnected to Germany, Sweden, and Norway. South Australia is currently connected to the rest of the East Coast Australian grid, but we're at the long of a long skinny transmission line with not a whole lot of capacity in the interconnectors. They do tend to get clogged up on very sunny, windy days, and their infrastructure is physically vulnerable too, and have on occasion failed, as I am going to talk about in a minute. If you look at any of the large net zero scenarios, you will see that the bulk of the future world's electricity generation is expected to come from wind and solar. It is simply not possible to expand hydro everywhere so that each country could follow the lead of Iceland or Norway. Geothermal, biomass, and nuclear each have their own issues with location, scalability, and cost standing in their way. So the challenges that South Australia is overcoming as it pushes towards 100% variable renewable electricity, it's really blazing a trail that other countries are going to end up following. So what does it mean to operate an electricity grid dominated by variable renewables and minimal connections to the other grids? Let's take a look in depth, starting with how South Australia has gotten to where it is today. South Australia embarked on its energy transition journey with little to no renewables until 2008, predominantly relying on a blend of coal and gas to power its grid. However, the landscape began to shift, marking a significant milestone in May 2016 with the closure of the state's last coal power plant. That year, wind and solar power contributed 40% to the electricity mix. But the commitment to renewable energy was tested during a devastating blackout that year in September when the state experienced a once-in-50-year storm that included two tornadoes with wind speeds up to 260 kilometres per hour. These tornadoes ripped 22 transmission towers out of the ground and three major transmission lines were brought down. This initiated a series of reactions. 9 wind farms in the state's mid-north activated protection features that caused an immediate and substantial reduction in power output. The fall of the 22 high-voltage power pylons triggered automatic safety switches, safeguarding the broader South Australian power network and the national electricity market. The reduction in wind farm output caused a surge in imported power through the Hayward interconnector, which tripped offline within 700 milliseconds after reaching a critical flow level. The fossil fuel industry and politicians opposed to renewable energy seized on the blackout, and they pointed to the so-called dangers of adding too much renewable energy to the grid. At the time, I remember kind of holding my breath, wondering if this narrative would take off and halt progress of renewables in Australia. I mean, I guess it is technically correct that wind energy caused that blackout, in that it was energy in the wind that blew over all of the electricity infrastructure. And as I mentioned, there was a more real contribution from wind energy because sudden lowered output from some wind farms was a factor too. But despite the blackout seeming like a gift from God to anti-renewables campaigner, that narrative didn't seem to catch on and hasn't really done much to slow the energy transition in South Australia. So if you fast forward 7 years from that blackout, then in the last 12 months, renewables have supplied 70% of Australia's electricity. The breakdown was 45% from wind, 25% from solar, mostly rooftop solar, and gas is down to just 20%. The remainder is imports from the neighbouring state of Victoria. So, what challenges have had to be overcome to get to this point? Let's start with the most obvious, variability. We all know that the sun sets every night and not every day is windy. With a fossil fuel power plant, you can mostly control how much power is being generated at any time, but with wind and solar, it obviously varies. And I've mentioned a couple of times now that renewables made up 70% of the state's electricity grid in the past year, but that ranges from the best days, which were days like today, very sunny and windy, when more than 100% of demand was met by wind and solar and the rest exported. But on the worst day, which this year was May 22nd, a cold day with very little wind, renewables were only 17% of generation. And if we zoomed in and look at hourly or even shorter periods, we'd find even larger shortfalls. For now, that shortfall is mostly made up by gas and a little bit of imported energy from Victoria, which is still a coal-dominated electricity grid. South Australia is shifting that though. Batteries and more interconnectors are the main way that reliance on local gas and interstate coal are reducing. Let's start with batteries. South Australia was home to the world's original big battery, 100 megawatts at Hornsdale Power Reserve. It was actually the result of a famous Twitter bet between Australian billionaire Mike Cannon-Brookes and American billionaire Elon Musk. There are quite a few more grid-scale batteries by now, and the recently added 250 megawatt Torrens Island battery just about doubled capacity to about 500 megawatts, and we're really starting to see their contribution make a dent in the evening peak. 15% of demand has been met by batteries for a short period in recent evenings. Hundreds more megawatts of grid-scale batteries are currently under construction, most with longer durations of 2 or 4 hours. So they're definitely going to play a bigger role in the near future. Let's move on to interconnectors. South Australia is currently connected to Victoria, and we learned a little earlier in this video that when that goes down, the outcome is bad for the state. An interconnector between South Australia and New South Wales is under construction, which will be crucial to keep Australia's lights on in case the events of 2016 ever repeat themselves. For now, most of the electricity supplied from either New South Wales or Victoria is from coal, but as their grids displace coal with renewables, South Australia will benefit from these imports getting cleaner. And by connecting a larger geographic area, you'll reduce the chance of low wind across the whole area. More interconnectors also means that South Australia will be able to build even more wind and solar and export it on really sunny and windy days when generation is way more than the state can use themselves. And more wind and solar is on the way. To give just one example, a single project, Goyder Renewable Zone is currently under construction about 2 hours north of Adelaide. The plan is that it will eventually add 1200 megawatts of wind, 600 megawatts of solar, and 900 megawatts of battery storage. When you remember that South Australia's grid is only around 3000 megawatts, you can see that this new project is geared mostly around exporting South Australia's superior renewable resources to the eastern states. Interconnectors aren't the only kind of transmission needed though. There's also the fact that wind and to a lesser extent solar resources are often best in remote areas, far from where electricity is consumed. This means that new transmission lines need to be built to connect these resources to the grid. Building new transmission can be expensive and time consuming, and elsewhere in Australia, and actually a lot of places around the world are facing this problem, they have issues getting communities on board for the major transmission upgrades needed to connect all of the new wind and solar projects we need for the energy transition. Yet Electranet, South Australia's transmission company, they've built so many kilometres of new transmission in recent years, and they're still going. They haven't had as much trouble as their eastern neighbours, and part of that is probably good management, but another part is also their luck that their transmission lines don't run through prime agricultural land like they do in New South Wales and Victoria. They are mostly running through the deserts. So that means that they're collaborating with traditional owners instead of with farmers, and that seems to have actually gone pretty smoothly in this case. And now the final challenge that I want to talk about in South Australia's energy transition is power system strength. Managing the electricity grid isn't quite as simple as making sure that sufficient electricity is available when and where people want to use it. Power quality also needs to be maintained. That is a measure of how well the voltage, frequency, and waveform of an electrical supply meets the needs of the equipment that uses it. In the past, this was ensured by the physical inertia of thermal generators. Coal and gas turbines are just really big and heavy. So if there's a sudden disturbance to the grid, they actually physically cannot slow down very quickly. They just keep on spinning, and so the grid stays pretty stable. Now that there is enough renewables in the system to power all the state's needs, you should in theory be able to turn off your thermal generator. But you can't, because they're still needed to run a certain amount of them to ensure that the power quality is maintained. The way that South Australia is addressing this is with synchronous condensers and grid-forming inverters. Recently, South Australia has installed 4 synchronous condensers, which are basically just big, physically spinning loads, but they use electricity to spin up, not burning fossil fuels. They've already installed 4, and as a result, that's taken the minimum number of thermal generators, which in South Australia's case is gas, taken the minimum number of those needed at any time from 4 down to 2. The second zero emissions way to ensure power system strength is grid-forming batteries. That 250 megawatt Torrens Island battery that I mentioned earlier is the biggest in the world to feature grid-forming inverters. And with all the new batteries coming online soon, I think that the grid-forming inverters in form of batteries is going to be the main way that we maintain power system quality in the future. So that's really just a snapshot of some of the coolest parts, well, what I think are the coolest parts of South Australia's energy transition. I definitely missed out on quite a lot. There's a lot going on with rooftop solar, for example, household batteries. And I have actually made another video on what South Australia is doing with vehicle to grid. So make sure you check that one out. Maybe next time I'm visiting, I'll cover some of the other cool things that are going on here. So if you think I've missed something particularly important, then let me know in the comments. So much progress has been made in a short space of time, and looking to the future, it's really not going to slow down. Even over the next few years, as their plans progress, we should start to see the role of gas dwindling even further. And by the end of the decade, it should be pretty close to zero. So I'm super excited by everything that's going on here in South Australia. If you're a South Australian, then I hope you feel proud. And if you're from somewhere else, perhaps you didn't realize how far South Australia has progressed in their energy transition. And I hope that you'll feel inspired that a mostly wind and solar electricity grid is possible. And, you know, things really can move fast. Thanks to the Engineering with Rosie Patreon team for supporting this video. If you'd like to join us and suggest video topics or have input on upcoming videos, also chat with like-minded people on the exclusive Engineering with Rosie Discord server, then you can join us at this link. We'd love to welcome you. Thanks for watching, and I'll see you in the next video.